My name is Vicki Lettman. I'm the literary advisor for the magazine. And we're very, very proud of this issue. We have some staff members here I want to introduce. We have Millie Chandler and Rachel Johnson. They're sitting in the middle there, and they're from the fall. Just to give you a little history of how we go about getting this thing accomplished, in the fall, we don't actually publish an issue, but we get going with the contest, and which is, you know, the winners of which are in this issue about the magazine. This magazine is almost as old as the college. We started it back in 1971, and at that time we had a very small budget, practically non-existent, and to do the cover, since we didn't have the graphic design people to help us, we actually used pieces of vinyl that one of our staff members had in his garage. We had those cut and had the signs from like 85th and Broadway, a picture of that sort of imposed on this vinyl cover. And it was very, it was just the beginning. We didn't have any artwork because at that time we really hadn't engaged the art people too much with the magazine. A few years after that, then we were able to get the art people to do more. And as the years have come now, it's like half art, and it's as much the art, an art magazine as it is a literary magazine. So it's a chance for the art people to showcase their work as well. We have the college to thank for allowing us to have the funding for this, because it is a very expensive proposition to publish this magazine and to give it out to our students, the staff, and even community people who might be interested, free of charge. Each issue costs us just about $250 to do, so it's a very, you know, expensive, nice magazine.
The story is called Death Leaves a Message. And again, if I start going too long, so I... No, 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 no! Harold Langhauser was torn between hysteria and confusion. He thrust the mop he had been using to clean his kitchen floor out in front of him and slowly backed away from the small stand containing his telephone and answering machine. Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, he bellowed. Hell, you might as well throw in their dog Spot, too. This simply cannot be happening. Ah, but it is happening, my elderly friend. The manufacturer's logo across the front of his answering machine seemed to widen in a fiendish grin. Are you feeling a little tight in the chest, Harold? A stabbing pain in your left arm, perhaps? Harold continued to stumble backward until his head made contact with the wall separating the kitchen from the front room. Oh! He wailed as he pried his left hand from the mop handle to inspect the mountain now rising up from the back of his skull. Damn it! He quickly glanced to his right and noticed that he was within arm's length of the kitchen closet that served as a catch-all for everything from booze to cooking utensils. Realizing that a mop was definitely not a suitable weapon against whatever type of monster had taken up residency in his answering machine, Harold, his eyes again fixed on the phone stand, pawed at the closed door and found the knob. He pulled it open a crack, threw the mop in, handle down, and slammed the door shut. He seemed oblivious to the noise which ensued as the mop hit the pots and pans, sending them sliding into the liquor and causing at least one bottle of Kentucky bourbon to fall to an untimely death on the floor. But Harold had more on his mind at that moment than the loss of a little booze, although a drink didn't sound like a bad idea just then. Either senility had finally reared its ugly head, as it so often does to 85-year-old men, or his answering machine wanted him dead. Life had not been a bowl of cherries for Harold, since Betty, his wife of 61 years, passed away just 11 months ago, leaving him all alone in their spacious two-story home in rural Trenton, Illinois. At first, he had found comfort in Jack and Marge, his son and daughter-in-law, who resided in the neighboring city of Highland and had stopped in to check on him and visit almost every day. But as the weeks flew by, these visits became fewer and fewer until 6 months ago, when Jack retired from his job with Madison County. At first, Harold had thought this would mean that he would be able to spend more time with his son. But when Jack and Marge insisted that he sell his home and move into a townhouse in the city, after which they informed him of their plans for retirement in South Florida, Harold's life hit rock bottom. Now, alone in the city, which he hated, with only Phil, Oprah, and Regis to occupy his time, Harold's sole joy came from the sporadic phone calls he received whenever Jack's golf games got rained out. In fact, his son's calls were so infrequent, he often wondered why Jack and Marge had given him a damn answering machine as a going-away present. It ain't like I'm ever going anywhere, he laughed,
If you really wanted to do something nice for me, you should have had him put a phone extension in the bathroom. That way I won't have to make a mad dash if I'm ever on the throne when you call. But they had insisted. Jack had hooked it up, and the damn thing had sat in relative silence ever since. That is, until 2 weeks ago. "I'm coming for you, Harold." It was always the same scratchy voice with the same haunting message. "Your time is almost up." At first he had written it off to local children attempting to break up the boredom of the long, hot August days. The messages were always waiting for him when he returned from one of his few excursions into the outside world, such as a trip to the market or a quick beer down at the Crow Bar. "Oh, sure," he'd thought. "Scare the old man. It ain't like I don't have enough problems staying regular as it is. Let him get all in a dither and plug him up real good. Damn punks." But the last few times he'd seen the little green message light blinking, he hadn't even left the house. "Damn phone never even rung," he'd scoffed. "I've been here all day. I'd have heard it if it had." And now, not 3 minutes ago, Harold had been doing his Saturday morning cleaning when there came the voice through his machine, just as nice as can be. "Hello, Harold. Your time has come." Harold stared at the answering machine from hell as his heart danced the hoochie-coochie in his chest.
Who are you?"
he stuttered as his feet remained glued in place. "Jeez, Harold," the phlegmy voice responded. "You look a bit pale. A man of your age, this much excitement, can't be good for the old ticker."
"If you're here to kill me..."
Harold's legs were growing tired as he leaned against the wall for support.
"The least you could do is identify yourself."
"I am the wind, whistling through the trees on a dark and stormy night," the mysterious voice seemed to laugh with delight. "I am the defenseless victim's scream when no one is around to hear. I am the haunting chime of the church bell as your loved one is eased into his final resting place. Nay, I am death itself."
"All right, already."
Harold knew one thing for sure. Whoever this guy was, he was extremely long-winded, with a great sense for the dramatic.
"Just get to the point, will you, pal?"
"I am your worst nightmare, Harold. I am
the Reaper."
As the voice rose to a crescendo, it suddenly slipped into a spasm of hacks and coughs. Upon clearing his throat and regaining composure, the prattle began again, only this time the phlegmy sound was gone, replaced by a voice that sounded to Harold quite nasal and actually, well, kind of weeny. "And I have a terrible sinus problem." Harold began laughing so hard that the wall was no longer sufficient support. He stumbled towards the kitchen table adjacent to the phone stand and plopped down in one of the padded brown chairs.
"You got a lot of guts, buddy, I'll say that much for you," he howled. "So tell me now, who are you really?"
Harold grabbed the machine from the phone stand and began examining it as if it were top secret government information.
"And how are you doing this trick with my machine?"
"I am the Reaper," the voice whined, "and you are supposed to be dead."
"And just how are you going to do that?"
Harold put the machine back in its proper place on the stand.
"Make me laugh to death?"
"My plan was to frighten you to death," the Reaper confessed. "At your age, that shouldn't have been difficult."
"I may be old, but I was military. Served from the time I was 18 until the end of WW2. It takes a lot more than some weird message on a machine to get my goat."
Harold leaned back in his chair, scooted out in from under the table, and lifted his right leg up and over his left knee.
"Things like that may rattle me a mite, and you certainly did do that, but kill me? Not today, partner. Anyway, if you really are the Reaper, why don't you just come after me with that big old hook of yours?"
"It's a scythe."
"You mean as in stop or no U-turn?" Harold mused. "What do? Whack people over the head with it?"
"Not sign, you idiot," the Reaper lost his cool. "Scythe. S-Y-S-C-Y-T-H-E. Scythe."
"You're the one trying to kill someone using an answering machine, and I'm the idiot?" Harold grinned. "That's a hoot."
"I only tried this method because we study our assignments before we are actually sent on them, and, well, you seemed like a nice guy," the Reaper explained. "I wanted to go easy on you. And by the way, you can't lie to a Reaper. I know you were more than a little spooked."
"Can you come out of that machine?"
Harold questioned.
"No. Once we have chosen our method, we're stuck with it."
"Well, then I ain't spooked no more," Harold chuckled. "You can bet on that."
"Is that so?"
The Reaper sounded as if he had more than one trick up his sleeve.
"Well, if you refuse to die now, then they may send Vinny for you later. And believe me, you don't want that."
"What?"
Harold was slightly confused.
"You mean to say there's more than one of you?"
Very good, Sherlock. Sarcasm now tinged the Reaper's voice. A mortal with any brains at all would have figured that out by now. There are lots of us.
How's that possible?
We are angels who, for one reason or another, have temporarily fallen out of the good graces of God. Thus, we are put on Reaper detail.
Kind of like with latrine duty.
Harold uncrossed his legs and leaned forward in his chair, his elbows resting on his knees.
Correct. And most of us hate it. The Reaper attempted to make his voice sound threatening, but only succeeded in deepening his whine. Most of us, that is, but Benny. He's the one who actually looks the way you mortals picture us, and he carries the sight.
Sounds charming.
Oh, he'll charm you, old man. The Reaper paused for effect. Charm you straight to hell. You see, Benny loves his work. He loves being ugly. He loves killing mortals, and most of all, he loves having his picture on Halloween cards. He even went to great lengths to get assigned to Reaper detail.
Oh, and how exactly did he do that?
Harold shifted in his seat.
He tied God's shoelaces together on April Fool's Day and then yelled fire. He'll be doing this for a long, long time.
I guess.
So how's about it? The Reaper decided to go for broke. Are you ready to give yourself over to me now, or do I let Benny take a crack at you later?
Well,
Harold wasn't sure what to believe. After all, Vinny could simply be a bluff. He didn't know if Reapers could lie or not, but he wouldn't put anything past them. He decided to stall for time.
Let's hear your story first. How did you get to be a Reaper?
Well, a few of us angels made a wager on who would win the Stanley Cup this year. I put my money on the New Jersey Devils. I mean, hey, they got a good team this season, right?
Yep,
Harold agreed.
They're pretty tough.
Right, the Reaper continued. Well, I only recently died myself, and little did I know that in heaven it's okay to bet on the Blues, the Mighty Ducks, the Blackhawks, or the Sharks, but you never, never, never cheer for a team called the Devils.
Sounds like a pretty minor offense to me,
Harold offered.
Yeah, the Reaper agreed. With any luck, I won't be pulling this detail for long. I'm really not cut out for this. I was an accountant in life, you know.
No, I...
Harold had no idea how the Reaper could possibly expect him to have known that fact, or for that matter, that he would even give a damn.
Yep, to Harold's delight, the Reaper continued to ramble. Rommerskirken's the name. Norbert Rommerskirken. Had my own practice in Mason City, Iowa. Rommerskirken tax preparers. Did quite well, even if I do say so myself.
Harold burst into a fit of laughter that brought the Reaper jetting back to reality.
And just what do you find so amusing, my soon-to-be-deceased friend?
Well, it's nothing personal, you understand,
Harold fought to regain his composure.
But being escorted into the afterlife by Norbert Rommerskirken, the Reaping Accountant,
he failed miserably,
seems about the same as Elvis having a bodyguard named Zippy the Wonder Chimp.
Harold began laughing so hard he began to struggle to keep his bottom row of dentures from falling out. The Reaper, on the other hand, was not equally amused.
All right, Harold, he howled. I've dawdled with you long enough. What is your decision? Do you come with me now, or do I have to resort to other tactics?
Oh, so what happened to Vinny?
Harold continued to chuckle.
Is he out of the picture now?
I don't need Vinny to deal with the likes of you, old man, the Reaper roared. I've got more tricks up my sleeve.
Oh, let me guess.
Harold had to strain to get the words out between chuckles.
Next time I'll hear you in my microwave, or better yet, maybe the toaster.
You'll find out soon enough, the Reaper concluded. But let me say this. I have already taken the steps necessary to end your miserable life. I'd be careful what I do from now on if I were you. Laugh while you can, old man. Your moments are numbered. Click. The line went dead.
Harold continued laughing to himself for a moment or two as he pondered the idea of calling his son.
Wait till Jack hears about this, he smiled. There ain't no need to fear the Reaper. Hell, he's just an accountant from Iowa named Norbert Rommerskirken.
He reached for the phone and paused.
I'll better make myself a drink first,
he mumbled and strolled across the kitchen, still chuckling to himself.
Lord knows I could use it.
As his hand grabbed the closet doorknob, he contemplated the last words the Reaper had said.
I wonder what he meant by, I have already taken the steps necessary to end your miserable life, and I'd be careful what I do.
But Harold had little time to think. He opened the door, and a blonde head of hair came flying towards him. It only took Harold a few seconds to realize that it wasn't a head at all, but simply the mop he had thrown in the closet, handle down, not so long ago. But his old heart wasn't used to this much excitement in one day.
few seconds was all it needed to seize up and stop. Harold fell to the floor, dead. Just then, the phone began to ring. Harold's answering machine waited the usual three rings before kicking in. The message was brief. Gotcha.
So I'm just going to call them out, and a couple of the staff members here, and Scott's here too, but are going to come up and help give these out. So for Death Leaves a Message, Mark Jones, first place. For Afterlife, Chris,
Thank you.
Okay. For Afterlife, Chris Hawking, third place.
Can't make it go.
Huh?
It's recording.
Yeah, it's recording now. The red light just came on.
Okay.
So close. Get into the sand. Into the cheap seat.
What's the score now?
5-0
5-0
I got one left yet. So you got a curfew now, huh?
Sorry.
Is that first one on there, Rob?
Huh?
Oh! That might be a point, though. Yeah, I don't know. Hit this one a little closer, will you, John? Now you don't both get a point, right? It's whoever's the closest.
I think so.
Right?
Why?
You don't both get a point, it's whoever's closer?
Whoever's the closest is gonna win a hard shoe and a peg.
Six to one.
How much do you want me to take?
No, you go first.
I wasn't doing anything though.
No.
Close to the right.
I forget all my time that this one makes a play. What do I do about that, Brad?
Just turn it down. No point. 6-1 Wait until
third of the way there now.
Huh?
Working fine now.
And all of a sudden it stopped. Gave it to Jan and she said the same thing.
did you do to it?
But now, come over, look at this.
No good.
Well, Dad, you're going to be up here pretty quick.
Way shallow.
You hear?
See, the southern boy is kicking butt. I think that's two more. I don't know.
Probably about 20, 30 minutes ago.
No good.
One more point. Sometimes I do. I usually do it on the second one.
Still 20 to 2. 1 point will end it.
Well, I don't know, before you throw it out, let me tell you something. If you get a rigger, you got to take 3 points off.
Oh, baloney.
The way it is, you got to collect one right on.
Is that right? Knock it off. There's game.
21 to 2.
The same mop.
It's John.
You want any barbecue sauce on your dog biscuits?
Yeah. Don't look like no points were scored. No points that time around. We'll come back to the action once one of them gets on the board. It's a point there. Oh, and John hits the pipe. So it's 1-0. Dad takes the early lead. Hits and goes wide. He might have a point there. Yep.
Sure I do.
1-1. John ties it up.
Okay, John. Go for it, kid. Okay. No.
And here we have the the woman of the house.
Okay, that's enough of me. Go away.
No points. And here we have Pretty Poo and Little Mo. Yeah. Wave, guys. Yeah, there's the pretty babies. There they are.
Did you hear it?
And the dog goes, burf, burf.
Yeah, mine.
Oh, hush.
Oh, you're not. Not you.
You're too smart for your own good. You didn't hear that, did you?
Yeah, I did.
About the dog biscuits?
About the dog biscuits?
Yep. Oh, she loves all that stuff.
Yeah, but I was asking Dad, referring to his meat.
Oh.
Barbecue sauce on your dog biscuits, and the dog goes,
What's the score?
Ones.
Nicely, it is.
Gonna have a cutoff of midnight on this one. See, I knew eventually I'd get hot. It was just a matter of if John got hot before I got hot, but I knew I would. No points.
So we can brainstorm things in the future we'll be distributing.
When's that again? Well, congratulations on your success. This sounds like a very attractive basketball, and let's get those numbers one more time so that if people are interested in ordering, they can order quickly.
Sure, 1-800-345-2868, and from Missouri, it's 314.
There he is. Heading for St. Louis. It puts those who can
work. Heading for Sauget or Centerville.
So, John, what do you think of the trip so far?
It's been cool. Could do without some of the rain, but, you know.
Yeah, it's been pretty soggy.
Yep. Very Sauget.
Yeah, it's like, we're gonna just keep on here.
towards the center, please, so everyone's on the stairs.
We have to keep on moving on the center. Wait, Steph,
come on,
Alex. Josh, I'm
back.
Josh, please rock. Josh, go down right here.
Where is the plane?
John, let's get a shot of you looking out the window.
Tegan.
Are you impressed?
Yeah, I like it. You can even see when we were at the game earlier.
Surprise, thank you. I even saw the balls and I go, it must be some
Gotcha. Troy, were you surprised?
No, I knew it was coming.
What?
Yes.
Gotcha.
Well, I guess now, Troy, we have to get married.
Oh. Is that
right? Yeah, I didn't hear that. Troy.
That's a girl with a ring on, and that's a boy.
Cute.
That's you, and that's Troy.
Right, yeah. We're never going to
yeah.
That's cute. That's pretty. God, you see it.
Yep.
Many of us are.
But, uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I
know.
Possibly never.
Yeah, I know.
Oh, here we go.
See, I wonder who this one's from.
From Mark.
Wow.
Is this from Mark?
Troy and Steph
are
sticking
around
the
I wrote the red part.
Good job.
Pass the cards around.
Yeah, I want to see that one.
Linda knows mine pretty well.
Well, you're always such big fans of that show, so I thought, well, I'll do that one.
That was nice. Yeah. Nice. Good job.
Whoa. Somebody's eating fancy here.
Oh, what is it?
Oh, confetti.
Oh, that's fun. Come
on, you're no fun. Yes. Oh, pretty. Let's see. Him. Wow.
Oh,
okay.
Create a
card.
You can do it if you want. You can do it if you want.
There you go.
Oh, that's cute.
I got the star on.
Oh, I would give you your card. That was pretty, Linda. Thank you. I like the laugh.
Careful of opening it up.
Look at his face.
Oh.
Is that for you?
Yeah, that was for me. It was a cute little card.
I already gave you your card.
Yep.
Let's see.
That's why we signed that one. I didn't really have time in the next last couple days.